Good evening. You're watching Left, Right and Center. I'm Nidhi Razdan. Tonight, it's a simmering issue in Jammu and Kashmir, one which could snowball very soon. At stake is an article of the Constitution that is linked to Jammu and Kashmir's special status, which is being challenged in the Supreme Court. The question is whether there is an attempt to dilute the special status. And that is the question that is at the heart of why Chief Minister Mehbooba Mufti did the unthinkable this week, reaching out to the opposition national conference as Kashmiri parties come together to oppose this. Today, she met Home Minister Rajnath Singh in Delhi on the issue and is expected to meet the Prime Minister and Sonia Gandhi as well in the next few days. The row is over Article 35A. It's a constitutional provision that allows Jammu and Kashmir to bar outsiders from buying land or property or getting government jobs. It's a provision that the state got thanks to Article 370, which gives Jammu and Kashmir its special status and which is how it acceded to India in the first place. The controversy erupted in 2014 after a little-known NGO called We the Citizens filed a PIL in the Supreme Court asking for Article 35A to be struck down. The NGO says it's discriminatory. But the issue is an extremely sensitive one in Kashmir, where the fear is that the BJP and the Sangh Parivar want to dilute the special status so that there can be demographic changes. Mehbooba Mufti herself, who's of course an alliance partner of the BJP there, warned just days earlier that there will be no one to shoulder the Indian flag in the Kashmir Valley if the special status was tampered with, while Farooq Abdullah said that scrapping the article could lead to a mass of people rising. Well, my colleague Tanima Biswas now joining us for more on that developing story. Tanima, we know that the Chief Minister has met Rajnath Singh on this. What more can you tell us about this meeting and the fact that, you know, she may be meeting other opposition leaders and the Prime Minister now in the next few days?
That's right, Nidhi. The first important thing, of course, is that the meeting today seems to be a completely unscheduled meeting. We know that the J&K Chief Minister was here in the national capital trying to get a hearing with the Prime Minister Modi himself. But for the moment, what we are being told by our sources is that she has not been given time yet, but she's still camping in the national capital, hoping that she will be able to meet the Prime Minister tomorrow and also most likely the Congress President Sonia Gandhi as well. But today it was a short meeting, lasted between 5:30 to 6 in the evening. The Chief Minister left without speaking to the media. That's also unusual because usually she does stop her vehicle and address the media for a little while and also takes questions. But this time around, her convoy did not stop at all. So there is speculation still exactly whether the meeting was entirely just about Article 35A, but most likely it is. That's what we are being told by our sources. As usual, even the last time around that we saw, right after the Amarnath Yatra attack, when J&K Chief Minister was in the national capital that time as well, it was the Home Minister Rajnath Singh who met her. She did not get a hearing with Prime Minister then as well, but she is still hopeful, and which is why she's camping back at the national capital, hoping that she will be able to hear what the centre's view on this issue is from the Prime Minister himself, Nidhi.
Right, all right. Tanima, thanks a lot for that. And let me just go straight across to senior BJP leader, Mrs. Seshadri Chari, who joins us tonight from Mumbai. Mr. Chari, let me just ask you straight off about what Mehbooba Mufti said on this issue just days earlier, saying that if the special status of J&K is tampered with, there will be no one to shoulder the Indian flag in the valley. It will be a death knell to the mainstream here. We will cease to exist. We will have nothing to tell our people. What would you say to that, Mr. Chari?
No, I don't agree with this attitude of Mehbooba Mufti. This issue is before the Supreme Court. The central government has taken a stand that this is a sensitive issue, and they have suggested that the Supreme Court should itself examine this issue in all its perspectives, and a very knowledgeable and studied Supreme Court committee can really do justice to this whole issue. So central government has not become party and part and parcel of this in any case. In this respect, Supreme Court becomes, it's a constitutional authority. Supreme Court is not an extra constitutional authority. So Supreme Court has to take a decision on this issue, and any statement by the Chief Minister, none other than the Chief Minister, saying that there will be nobody to carry a flag of India on their shoulder and there will be violence and there will be opposition and all these things, are actually dabbling with the independence of the Supreme Court.
This you're is criticizing her.
Affecting the decision-making process of the Supreme Court. And I think this is not done. Mehbooba Mufti should be more responsible in her responses. She has her government has already put forward their views to the Supreme Court, and they should allow the Supreme Court to come to a decision.
She is your ally,
making
though, Mr. Chari.
Irresponsible statements.
You're accusing the J&K Chief Minister of being.
Pardon?
You're saying that she's being irresponsible in her statements, but you're in government together in Jammu and Kashmir. So this is a rather odd situation right now.
Yes, it's very sad and very unfortunate. It is very sad and very unfortunate. I do not agree with the views of the BJP in the Jammu and Kashmir state. And the central government also does not agree with that. That is the reason why the central government has told the Supreme Court that they are free to take a decision and examine the situation on their own count. Number one. Number two, it is not just making a statement by the Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir. She is actually threatening the judiciary.
Those are pretty strong words from you, Mr. Chari. You're accusing her of threatening the judiciary as well. Let me just take your...
I repeat. She is threatening the judiciary. This is bad.
All right. Pretty strong words from you, Mr. Chari. And I'll just take those to Mr. Nizamuddin Bhatt first of the PDP, who's joining us from Srinagar tonight. Mr. Bhatt, Mr. Chari is a very senior veteran leader of the BJP. A senior political commentator. This is quite scathing criticism from your own ally of the Chief Minister and the PDP's position on this.
I see this as a personal view. Maybe he is enjoying a very, very senior position in the party. I take it as his personal view. And anybody has a right to express his personal views, his personal perception on any issue. As far as we are concerned, PDP, we have already made our position known when we entered into alliance with BJP. We have already sought that they should not do anything that racks up any controversy about Article 370. That's part of the agenda of alliance and they have agreed. As far as his attributions to central government and state government, I don't agree with Mr. Chari. As I said, these are his personal views. Central government as such has not taken any open stand. This is a very, very sensitive political issue with constitutional, political, as well as diplomatic ramifications. Because Jammu and Kashmir, by its status, has certain extra constitutional contours too. So, as far as central government is concerned, we understand, PDP understands, people of Jammu and Kashmir understand that they have as yet not taken any stand, either for
but
or
Mr.
against
Bhatt,
the entire
Obviously,
the,
you're worried
Let me ask you this. It is unprecedented what we saw earlier this week. One second, Mr. Bhatt.
Earlier this week, the Chief Minister actually reached out to the National Conference, and it is unprecedented. We haven't seen these scenes probably ever, or at least not in recent memory. So this is your own ally. You are in alliance with the BJP in Jammu and Kashmir. And therefore, have you been able to have a conversation with the BJP in the state?
Nidhi, try to understand. Try to understand. Mehbooba
is
head of a
part of the government.
She is heading a state. And there is an issue. There is an issue which has racked up in national debate. She is within her rights to go to know views of anybody who is in politics or who has a stake in Jammu and Kashmir. Meeting Farooq Abdullah is a good move. And as far as this question is concerned, that why didn't she go to directly to central leadership?
I'm just asking whether you've had a chance to have a conversation with the BJP on this, which is your partner.
You see, when you say state government, somebody has gone to court and state government responded. When you say state government, it is not PDP government. It is both government of PDP as well as BJP. They should concur with the views. I don't see that Deputy Chief Minister who is representing BJP in the government has taken a different view.
Okay, Mr. Bhatt, I understand what you're saying, which is what Mr. Chari is disagreeing with. He's sticking his neck out and he's saying he doesn't even agree with what position the state BJP has taken. He's very clear on where he stands on this. Junaid Mattu, if you could explain to us, see, why this can, is such an explosive issue.
So sensitive an issue.
I just want to ask Junaid
you,
that
you
question.
You can have different views. But that's why we say this is controversial. I am asking why
is this such an explosive issue that we are seeing this sort of unprecedented coming together of opposition parties in the state, and this whole controversy which has been simmering until now is suddenly snowballing. Junaid.
Well, it is a very sensitive issue, primarily because the accession of Jammu and Kashmir to the Union of India, as much as BJP and RSS deny it, is not an accession that happened in normal, ordinary circumstances, in normal, ordinary backdrop. And whatever the bargained special status, I disagree with Nizamuddin Butt Sahab, there is nothing extra constitutional about it, it's all constitutional. Whatever the bargained special status that was made available to Jammu and Kashmir, that is the premise and the basis of the only Muslim majority state's accession into the Union of India at a time when, you know, the two-nation theory found buyers and sellers in the rest of the subcontinent. I also, with a lot of regret, say that both Mr. Chari and Mr. Butt have been very disingenuous, with all due respect to them. When Butt Sahab says that the state government responded and what else was the state government supposed to do, my point is that this matter has been adjudicated twice before in 62 and 69. This is the first time when the central government chose, it was a deliberate decision, they chose not to file a written counter response and said that they were in favor of a larger debate. Now you go back to the agenda of the alliance. In the agenda of the alliance, the BJP and the PDP apparently and allegedly agree that there will be a status quo on the special status of Jammu and Kashmir. If there is a status quo, then that agreement should have been reflected in the act of the central government filing a counter response to this PIL in the Supreme Court. But they chose not to do it. They have made 17 or 18 promises in the agenda of the alliance. You're talking about the contradictions, Junaid, within the alliance. But before we come back to the politics, Mr.
Mr. Chari, just give me a second. Before we come back to the politics of this, I just want to bring in Mr. Dushyant Dave, senior advocate of the Supreme Court, to explain to us about why Article 35A legally, where it stands in the Constitution of India. We know that the Supreme Court is looking at this matter. In fact, it's not the first time, Mr. Dave, that the court has taken cognizance of this issue. There have been petitions filed before every time the court has upheld Article 35A. Mr. Dave.
Well, let's understand one thing, and that is this, that the constitutional provisions, insofar as state of Jammu and Kashmir is concerned, are, very special provisions, which under the article, the constitution's chapter for special provisions are, made not only for Kashmir, but are made for states like Nagaland, Mizoram, Sikkim, and many other states. There are many rights of the Mizo people and the Naga people which are specifically protected under the constitution, which is almost pari materia to what has been done in Kashmir. Now, Kashmir was a little different position, because in 1947, when the instrument of accession was signed on October 26, 1947, it was an extraordinarily fragile situation. The Maharaja of Kashmir, who signed the agreement with Lord Mountbatten, only agreed for the accession on certain specific terms. Now, it was on the basis of those specific terms, which exclude the power of the Union legislature to legislate in respect of any matter except those that he agreed expressly in the schedule to the instrument of accession, the Parliament has no power at all. Now, it was because of that these provisions were brought in, in the Constitution. And this presidential order of 1954, by virtue of which Article 35A was brought in, was really brought in those circumstances because of the experience that was gained by the government in consultation with the state government. These are issues which unfortunately cannot be, raked up today except with the concurrence of the state legislature. Same provisions are there for Mizoram and Nagaland in different way. I mean, not for this very issue, but some other issues. Now, are we going to really today, treat these issues as open for discussion? Just a minute. Open for discussion and say that, you know, this issue should be raked up. Secondly, let us not forget one thing, that today Kashmir is in an extremely dangerous situation. What is the point of, you know, having this debate today when situation is virtually gone out of the hands of control of the government? Nobody wants to lose Kashmir. Kashmir is part and parcel of India. It's an integral part of India. But having said that, government should also be very slow. I would strongly urge my friends in BJP and RSS, including Mr. Chari, that let us tread little carefully, okay. Try and see how we can bring at least the large population with us before we debate this.
All right. What you said very importantly, and Mr. Chari, I think that is the point that that we often come back to, is that if you question Article 35A, then you have to relook at the entire accession of Jammu and Kashmir all over again to India, because this all then goes back to Article 370 and the circumstances under which J&K acceded. And also, the state subject laws, which are currently
let me finish.
They were introduced by Maharaja Hari Singh in 1927 because the Dogras in Jammu wanted to protect their land and they wanted to protect their jobs. They were worried about people coming in from Punjab and from elsewhere. And that is originally where these state subject laws originate from. That's the irony, Mr. Chari.
You see, that's the point that I was trying to make. This was not invented by the governments after 1947. The fact is, it was the Maharaja who wanted to protect Jammu and Kashmir from the British. And this is the sentence that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru has used in the Indian Parliament, saying that the Maharaja did not want the British to come and settle in Jammu and Kashmir, and that was the reason why he wanted some provision whereby he can stop. And the Maharaja specifically used another word, I do not want Punjabis.
It was also people from Punjab, neighboring states.
Exactly. Punjab also. That time Punjab was the neighboring state. There was no Himachal Pradesh at that time. But that apart, when this was agreed in 1947, I take strong objection to those people who say that the accession was conditional. The accession was unconditional. Accession to of Jammu and Kashmir was irrevocable, and the accession to of Jammu and Kashmir was complete in its own process, and the process of accession was not different from the accession of all the riyasats, 545 or 575 riyasats of the country.
Article 370 is there for a reason.
Document. I am telling you.
Of course it was.
I am telling you. Please go.
You've rewritten history just now.
Go and check the accession document. You can go and check the accession document. The accession document.
Leave alone. Look beyond the document. Look beyond the document. This is a very superficial argument that BJP makes. That look at the document. It's a pro forma document.
When you want to, if you
want to look beyond the document, we have Article 370. We have our own constitution. We had our own constituent assembly. And we have our own state flag. We have a subautonomous character. Look beyond the piece of paper which you claim is pro forma. We never merged with the Union of India. If you say the process is complete, then you are omitting the fact that we never merged with the Union of India. The accession was conditional. If you don't agree it was conditional, then why do we have a flag? Then why do we have our own constitution? Then why do we have our own penal code?
Be little more.
Let Mr. Chari finish his point. Yeah, okay.
Give me another half a minute.
Go ahead, sir.
We had beyond the accession document, we also had a discussion with many of these riyasats on privy purse. This privy purse was abolished by Mrs. Indira Gandhi. Did you raise a bloody word on that? Why did you keep quiet? It was a promise to all these Maharajas that they will give dole privy purses.
Dushyant Dave wants to
that
come
was
in.
Not kept.
Mr. Dave, Mr.
Things
Dave.
Change. Situations change. And
situations
and
change.
1917 was the first time that Maharaja raised this issue.
History seems to be rewritten. There seems to be a bit of rewriting of history here. Mr. Dave, I'll give you the last quick. We just have a minute left. Go ahead, Mr. Dave.
You know, in the instrument, Mr. Chari perhaps would know, the instrument of accession specifically says Maharaja says that I hereby declare that I accede to dominion of India, but subject always to the terms of this accession agreement. And Article 6 of that agreement says that nothing in this instrument shall empower dominion of legislature to make any law for this state authorizing anything else. Now, Gujarat, for example, I'll tell you, Nidhi, Himachal does not allow outsiders to buy land.
Exactly.
Gujarat, I can't buy agricultural land, although I am a Gujarati, because I am not a farmer. Now, many states have these kind of laws. We have to respect these laws because they were made for peculiar reasons for protecting the local population. Nothing wrong about it. I don't think these are matters which Nidhi, really should be, you know, equated with some kind of nationalism or some kind of integrity of India.
Well, I have to leave it there today. I'm out of time, Mr. Chari, but I would Mr. like to Dave, revisit this debate once the Chief Minister meets the Prime Minister. We are expecting her to meet the Prime Minister perhaps in the next day or two. I'm out of time, Mr. Chari. I have to leave it there tonight. We will continue to follow this story, and I'd like to invite all of you back once we do. Thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you.